Okay, good morning everyone. Welcome to the ECSS 2021 Virtual Congress. It's a pity we can't be together again this year, but we're hopeful for next year. And I know we've got a nice meeting coming ahead. This morning's session is OPPN09 that you're now currently attending, and we have a number of Young Investigator Award oral presentations. To save time, I think we should immediately start. So I would first like to invite the first presentation from Fuchs and colleagues, entitled Ingesting Raw Eggs to Support Muscle Reconditioning. Did Rocky Get It Right or Wrong? Thank you. Over to you, Cass.
I'm trying to share my screen, but it's now light gray again.
Yeah, Frederick, just a moment.
Yeah. No, that's me. That's I'm not presenting yet.
Should work. Sorry.
Yeah, now it does. Yeah, perfect. Right, can you see the screen?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So thank you very much for the introduction. And I would also like, obviously, to thank ECSS for the opportunity to present here today, again, in this virtual conference. So after exercise, many athletes ingest dietary protein, and they do this with the main aim to stimulate muscle protein synthesis. And this will allow them to accelerate recovery from exercise, but also to facilitate the skeletal muscle conditioning response to the previously performed exercise session. Now, after exercise, athletes can ingest different types of protein, and one commonly consumed and also high quality protein source are eggs. And indeed, eggs have previously been shown to potently stimulate muscle protein synthesis after resistance type exercise. And even more so when eggs are ingested in their whole form compared to when you would ingest only the egg whites, as you can see in this figure. Now, ingesting eggs around workouts is not something new, because Rocky already showed us in the 70s that he was ingesting raw eggs around his workouts. And this led many other athletes, recreational but also to professional, to do the same thing. However, what's interesting is that later on, scientific work actually showed that if you would look at the digestibility of raw eggs, that this is much lower compared to if you would ingest processed eggs. So in other words, if you would preheat eggs prior to consumption, so by boiling or cooking, for example, the digestibility is much higher. And so with raw eggs, to make it more specific, this is about 50%, whereas this is more than 90% if you would preheat the eggs prior to consumption. Now, this would suggest that if you would do that, that more of the amino acids from the eggs can actually become potentially available into the systemic circulation, and thereby also more could be used by the muscle to stimulate muscle protein synthesis. However, this has never been assessed in a study, and therefore we wanted to assess this in a research study. And we came up with the following hypothesis, which was that the postprandial rise in circulating amino acids will in fact be attenuated following the ingestion of raw eggs when compared to boiled eggs. And this would then lower the postprandial stimulation of muscle protein synthesis. Now, in order to investigate this, we recruited 45 healthy young male individuals, and they were all familiar with resistance type exercise. They came in a fasting state to our research laboratory, and this test day took about, on average, 9 hours. And what we first did in the morning in the fasting state was we took a blood sample, and you can see that here by us where we performed one of the blood samples in the fasting state of one of the participants. Then afterwards, we started the infusion of a labeled amino acid, which was 13C6 phenylalanine, and this is necessary to be able to calculate muscle protein synthesis rates during the day. Obviously, to look into the enrichment of this in the circulation, we need to take several more blood samples during the day. And we could also use this to look into the plasma glucose, insulin, and also the amino acid concentrations. Now, after 2.5 hour in rest, we performed, or we let our participants perform an exercise session, which was whole body resistance type exercise. And so we started with a warm up on the bike, so at a self-selected intensity for 15 minutes. Then we had our participants perform the leg press exercise. So this was for 4 sets of 8 to 10 repetitions at 80% one rep max. And this was all determined during a screening session. Then we did another leg exercise focusing on the quadriceps. So we did the leg extension exercise. So again, for 4 sets of 8 to 10 repetitions at 80% of the one rep max. And then we also did some upper body exercises. So we did 2 sets of 8 to 10 repetitions of 80% of the one rep max. And this was on the chest press. And we did the same for the horizontal row, for the shoulder press, and then also for the lateral pull down. Now, immediately after exercise, we took a muscle biopsy from the thigh, and so specifically from one of the quadriceps muscle groups, which was the vastus lateralis muscle. And you can see this procedure here in this picture, how we typically do this. So in the vastus lateralis, as you can see here, we take a small piece of muscle out that we can subsequently then analyze. Then afterwards, we provided the participants with the nutrition. So we randomly assigned the 45 guys into 3 different groups. And so one group got 5 raw eggs, one group got 5 boiled eggs, and the other group got 5 or got a controlled breakfast meal. And this contained a butter croissant with some butter, as well as some orange juice. And although the total amount of calories was similar between the treatments, the raw and the boiled eggs, they contained 30 grams of protein, whereas this was only 5 grams in the control meal. However, the control meal contained quite some carbohydrates, which was 45 grams, which was not present in the egg groups. And here you can see one of the participants who was ingesting the raw eggs after his workout and the biopsy. Now, after then the nutrition was ingested by the participants, we started the stopwatch, and then at time point 2, as well as at 5 hours, we again took a muscle biopsy to assess the muscle protein synthesis rate in the postprandial period. Now, what have we found in our study? If we first look at plasma glucose concentrations, we can see that in the basal period, there were no differences between the groups. However, in the postprandial period, you can see that with a dashed line, so at time point 0, you can see that in the egg groups, there was no increase in plasma glucose concentrations. And this obviously makes sense because they were not, or the egg groups did not contain any carbohydrates. However, you do see a clear increase in plasma glucose concentrations in the control breakfast group. And this also, again, obviously makes sense given the large amount of carbohydrates that was present in that meal. If we then look at the plasma insulin concentrations, so we see quite a similar pattern compared to the plasma glucose concentrations, which obviously makes sense. We found in the basal period, again, no differences between the groups. And even though it seems that there was a slight increase in the egg groups, this was not statistically significantly different. However, we did see a clear significant increase in the control breakfast group. And so there the plasma insulin concentrations were quite increased. And this again follows the same pattern compared to the plasma glucose concentrations. If we then look at the plasma amino acid concentrations, and so I here specifically depicted the essential amino acid concentrations. And I have to say here that, for example, the plasma brain chain amino acid concentration, the leucine, showed a very similar figure. So what we found here was that in the basal period, again, no differences between the groups. However, in the postprandial period, so again, after time point 0 and the dashed line, you can see that in the control breakfast meal, there was no increase in plasma essential amino acid concentrations, which again makes sense because there was only a low amount of protein available into that meal. However, you do see a clear increase in the egg groups. And this is even higher in the group that got the boiled eggs compared to the group that got the raw eggs. And this also makes sense given to what I mentioned in the introduction slides, that if you would process eggs prior to consumption, that the digestibility is much higher compared to if you would ingest eggs in the raw form. And so this would suggest this figure that indeed seems then to be the case that more of the amino acids from the eggs will become available into the systemic circulation if you would preheat the eggs prior to consumption. Now, what have we then found on muscle protein synthesis? So I have that depicted in this figure. So what we found is in the basal period, no differences between the groups. And this obviously also makes sense. However, in the post-exercise and postprandial period, you did see a clear increase in all groups in terms of muscle protein synthesis. And this also makes sense because we know that exercise, specifically resistance exercise, is a very potent stimulator of muscle protein synthesis. We also found about a 20% higher increase in the egg groups compared to the control breakfast group. However, there was no significant difference in the groups, between the groups. So based on these findings, what we can conclude is the following, that first of all, the ingestion of 5 boiled eggs increases plasma essential amino acid concentrations to a greater extent when compared to ingesting 5 raw eggs. However, the post-exercise muscle protein synthetic response does actually not differ after ingesting 5 raw or 5 boiled eggs. And so therefore, what we can say based on this study as a take-home message is that if you would consume raw eggs as opposed to boiled eggs, it doesn't seem to compromise the muscle protein synthetic response following a bout of whole body resistance type exercise. And therefore, it seems that Rocky did not compromise his muscle conditioning response by not boiling his eggs prior to consumption. So with this, I would like to thank my colleagues from the M3 Research Unit and also from the Maastricht University Medical Center. And I'm happy to answer any potential questions. So thank you very much for listening. And again, I'm open to hear any questions.
Thank you. The floor, because this is a YI presentation, I need to give the floor firstly to my colleagues who are reviewing the abstract. So are there any questions from my colleagues on the scientific committee and board? So first, can we have Jatin and then Jose?
Morning. So thank you very much for your presentation, very nice and clear. I just wondered what your explanation was for you had a clear difference in plasma amino acid levels between the boiled and raw eggs, but no difference in protein synthesis. So what's your explanation there? Why is one different and the other similar?
Yeah, what I think is the difference is that we gave 5 raw eggs. So in total, it was about 30 grams of protein. And I would expect that that's sufficient to maximally stimulate muscle protein synthesis rates in the post-exercise period. So basically, I think if you indeed give 30 grams of protein, if you also look at the guidelines, that's actually sufficient to have a maximal response. And in that situation, it doesn't seem to matter that much anymore how much is becoming available into the systemic circulation, at least obviously to a certain extent. So I think that a higher increase than a normal, what you see with the raw eggs in this case, does not lead to a further increase in muscle protein synthesis.
Okay, yeah. And just a question out of interest as well. So I know you guys have done the sort of heavy labeling of a whole cow. So could you have taken the same approach with a chicken? And what would have that given you extra insight to?
Yes, we could have done that. Actually, that's something we have discussed in the past as well to try this out. And it has been done by other labs already. Yes, if we would have done that, what we could get extra is we could also see how much of the amino acid really from that egg is actually becoming available into new muscle protein, basically. So we could see the incorporation of the amino acid coming from the egg into the muscle protein. So that's definitely something interesting that would give some more insights, but obviously it's quite expensive and also quite a lot of work to label eggs, but it's definitely something we are considering to do in the future.
Okay, quickly, thank you. Quickly over to Jose Calbet.
I don't know if Jose Antonio.
Oh, sorry, it was Jose Calbet.
I have just a quick question. Actually, with a very nice presentation and nice data, I was actually very surprised about the control condition, like where carbohydrate were ingested, that actually myofibril protein synthetic rate, it was identical to the other conditions of ingesting eggs. So can you explain that? It seems that actually ingesting having high that concentration of amino acid doesn't actually affect protein.
Yeah. No, it wasn't significantly different. That's true. We did see like a tendency for it, but we did see about a 20% difference. So the eggs did stimulate protein synthesis rates for 20% different or 20% higher compared to the control breakfast meal. And typically 20% is actually what we use with sample size calculations as a meaningful and clinically relevant difference between, for example, treatments if we do the sample size calculations. So I was also a bit surprised that we didn't pick it up significantly, but I do still think that 20% is quite a lot and does kind of suggest that the eggs would have been better or are better. Also, when I looked at the effect size calculations, it was between 0.63 to 0.7. So there seems to be quite some effect or higher effect of the eggs compared to the control condition, actually.
Okay. Thank you.
I'm afraid we're out of time. Thank you for your clear presentation. And I'm sorry, Jose Calbet, but you can ask it the next one.
No problem.
If we could move to the next speaker, please. So the title of the next presentation is Vitamin D Supplementation and Enhanced Dairy Protein Intake Do Not Affect Gain in Lean Mass, Muscle Strength, or Physical Performance in Healthy 6 to 8 year old Children, the DPRO Randomized Trial.
Oh, yes. Do you hear me? And yes. Do you see my PowerPoint?
Yes, it's quite small, but we can see it.
Is it better? So you just see my PowerPoint?
We can see you and we can see your part of your PowerPoint.
Is it better?
Okay, that's better. Thank you.
Yeah, good. Well, thank you very much. My name is Lina. I am from Denmark, and in Denmark, we have a lot of Lego, and we also have 5 months during the summer with gorgeous weather. Then for about 7 months, we quite rarely see the sun. The good thing about that is it makes it a great place to investigate the effects of vitamin D supplementations with very low interaction from sun exposure. And as some of you might know, most people living at northern latitudes are at risk of vitamin D deficiency during the winter. And as a result, muscle strength and physical function may be negatively affected, at least so it has been shown in adults, especially elderly. In children, however, evidence about the impact of vitamin D supplementation on muscle mass, physical function is sparse. Cross-sectional studies have shown some positive associations between vitamin D status and hand grip strength in children, but intervention studies have been quite short in duration and have also shown rather mixed results. Additionally, protein ingestion have been positively associated with muscle mass and strength in adults, but actually no intervention studies have investigated this in normal weight healthy children without a corresponding physical intervention. My third and final point before I get to the meat and potatoes is that quite recently, it's been demonstrated in rats that vitamin D supplementation complexed with milk proteins enhances the bioaccessibility of vitamin D in rats. So now we have hypothesis that both vitamin D and vitamin D supplementation and enhanced protein intake, and maybe also the combination of the two nutritions, may increase children's gain in lean mass, muscle mass, and physical function. So therefore, we set up a large randomized trial with 200 healthy children. And we aim to assess the effects of vitamin D and protein supplementation on these outcomes during a 24-week period over winter. We named the trial DPRO, and in addition to the results I will share with you today, we also looked at effects on bone mineralization, cardiometabolic markers, and immune system. The study was a 2x2 factorial randomized design. One of the arms were tablets. So the children had one chewable tablet per day with either vitamin D3 or placebo. And then the other arm was yogurt, where they consumed 260 grams per day with either high protein content or medium protein content. And as you can see, we had different flavors they could choose from in order to increase compliance. And all the products were handed out for free from our research kitchen. We recruited children by letter to their parents, and some important inclusion criteria were that they had to consume at least a quarter liter per day of milk products, so that the yogurts we provided would substitute other milk products in the diet rather than be in addition. Importantly, they could not be included if they took vitamin D supplementations or if they were planning a sunny winter vacation. Baseline visits were held in late August to October 2019, and then we conducted the trial and finished of all children from February to April 2020. So the last part of it was affected by COVID-19, and we had to reduce our protocol, and as a result, we didn't measure physical function on the last 60 children. But other than that, I'll say we were fairly fortunate and managed to get almost all other samples in house. So we had samples on muscle mass, lean mass, and the maximal strength. We conducted a number of measurements. We took a fasting blood sample, and by this we assessed vitamin D status. We conducted DEXA scans to measure body composition. So lean mass is here our estimate for muscle mass. To measure muscle strength and physical function, we tested leg press, vertical jump, long jump, hand grip strength. We did a 30-second sit-to-stand test. And we also measured a 7-day accelerometry in order to estimate their habitual activity level. And we obtained data about children's participation in organized sports by questionnaire. Finally, to get insight into children's habitual diet, we did both a 4-day food log and a food frequency questionnaires. So the basic overview is that we randomized 200 children, equally distributed on gender. They were on average 7.7 years old. Most of the children had normal weight, participated in organized sport, had not entered puberty, and only a few of the children had vitamin D insufficiency at baseline. And the average protein intake at baseline was 2.1 grams per kilo body weight per day. So that is well above the WHO protein recommendation of 0.9 for children of this age. Of the 200 children, we had a 5% dropout rate, and 3% of the children we couldn't follow up due to COVID-19 restrictions at endpoint. So all in all, we included 184 children in our analysis, so that is 92% of our randomized sample. Compliance was very high, above 95% for both the yogurt intervention and the vitamin D intervention. And at endpoint, all the children in the vitamin D supplemented group had sufficient vitamin D status, whereas 59% in the placebo group were either vitamin D insufficient or even deficient. So the meat and potatoes are very busy table, but there are two main points about our results, and that is regardless of group, children gained lean mass, muscle strength, and physical function, which was also expected now that we follow these growing children for 24 weeks, a half year. And then even though vitamin D supplementation prevented vitamin D insufficiency, we saw no effects on supplementation in any of these gains in lean mass, strength, or physical function when we compared to placebo. And the same story goes for the protein. When we compared children with normal versus enhanced protein intake, no effects were seen in the changes of these outcomes. Finally, we did not see overall any interactions effects when we combined the two nutritions. That is except for an interaction effect on the sit-to-stand test, but it disappeared when we adjusted for physical activity level. So to sum it up, neither vitamin D supplementation or enhanced protein intake affected gains in lean mass, muscle strength, physical function in these healthy and normal weight school age children. What remains unknown from our point of view, and especially in the context of this sports science conference, is whether the enhanced protein intake can promote superior increases in lean mass and strength if it were in very active children, like almost elite athletes. That is an open question. But for now, I want to thank Berman in Finland for donating the tablets, Arla Food for Health for funding the study. Of course, kudos to my colleagues from the DPRO team and all the participating children and their parents, and for you for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I can now open this for questions, please, from the floor. Jose Calbe.
Okay.
Hello.
Hi.
Excellent presentation and a very difficult study. You are congratulated for the success.
Thank you.
It's incredible you were able to do this with such small kids. So you have presented.
Oh.
Ooh.
He's gone.
Yeah, it's freezing.
While we wait, does...
can I have?
Yes, Maria.
Thanks. Yeah, I would like to take up on what Jose was saying and congratulate for your presentation and for the actually number of children that were tested, which is quite impressive. So if I understood correctly, also by the abstract, 90% participate in organized sports.
Yeah.
Correct. And how many of these were actually being physically active outdoors or indoors, also during the eventual daylight times? So did you account for this, for example? This is my first question.
Yeah, that is a very good question. We didn't account for it. Obviously, we have the data, but we didn't account for it because we tested them in this period from September to March, where the thermal synthesis of vitamin D, if you are outside participating in sports, is so minimal. Yeah, so that's why we didn't look at that.
My second question, if I may very quickly, is there also affects you in this period, especially in the winter, also mood and cognitive function. And I was wondering, and vitamin D also has an effect on both. So I was wondering if by any chance you were thinking of looking at those data as well, which are as important probably for the overall health of these children.
That is a very, very good point. I think from our entire test battery, that is probably the only thing we didn't test, unfortunately, but it would have been very nice to see. And especially, as you say, in regards to vitamin D, it would, I would have some hypothesis that it could affect them.
So I've got a quick question, if I may. So your protein intake in your abstract increased from 15.5% plus or minus 2.4% to 18% plus or minus 3.4%. Was this statistically different, and would you expect this to affect muscle protein synthesis, given that it's spread over the whole day?
It was significantly different, and what I expected, in a way, with these active children, I would, but still knowing that it is a marginal gain, and there are just, well, that is easy for me to say now, but there are just probably some bigger stones in the picture of what how these children develop, and then the increase of 0.5 grams per body weight per day is probably quite insignificant when they already take or eat so much at the baseline.
Okay. Thank you very much. We're out of time, I'm afraid, so we now have to move to the next presentation. The next presentation, abstract 398, cheese ingestion increases muscle protein synthesis rates both at rest and during recovery from exercise in healthy young males. And the presenter is Hermans, I believe.
Yeah, correct. Can you, see my presentation and hear me, Paul?
Perfect. Yes, cool. Thank you.
Thank you. So, yeah, my name is Wesley Hermans, and I'm a PhD student at Maastricht University. And at first, I would like to thank ECSS for organizing this conference and allowing me to present the data here to you. So I'll present to you indeed on the anabolic properties of cheese. So skeletal muscle tissue is an important organ for both metabolic health and functional capacity, and it turns over by about 1 to 2% per day. And this happens by muscle protein synthesis and muscle protein breakdown. However, we do need anabolic stimuli to maintain skeletal muscle mass. And there is two stimuli for muscle protein synthesis, which are physical activity and protein intake. And especially with regards to protein intake, there are several factors that modulate the anabolic response following protein ingestion. And these include like protein composition, but also protein digestion and amino acid absorption kinetics. However, most knowledge on postprandial protein metabolism has mostly been gained following the ingestion of easily digestible protein concentrates and isolates without any additional macronutrients. And in a regular diet, people more commonly consume their protein as whole foods or even mixed meals, and these involve several steps of processing. And in these whole foods, the protein is incorporated into a complex food matrix together with the other macro and micronutrients, and these all affect the metabolic impact that these foods have. So therefore, within nutrition research, there has been a call for more whole foods focus in research. So cheese is a typical protein-dense whole food that's commonly consumed in the Western diet. And cheese is produced from dairy milk by several steps of processing. But as a result, the food matrix of cheese is completely different from its source product, milk. And recently, a study has been published, and it investigated the postprandial amino acid concentrations following cheese and milk ingestion. And data show the cheese ingestion was followed by a lower but more sustained increase in amino acid concentrations when compared to milk. However, in this study, they did not investigate whether this also affected the capacity to increase postprandial muscle protein synthesis rates. So therefore, in our study, we aim to compare the postprandial amino acid concentrations following cheese versus milk protein concentrate ingestion. But more importantly, we also wanted to compare the muscle protein synthesis response following cheese versus milk protein concentrate ingestion at rest and during recovery from exercise. So in this randomized parallel group trial, 20 healthy young guys were included. And during a single test day, they received a primed continuous stable isotope amino acid infusion. And after 1 hour of pre-infusion, we took a muscle biopsy from the vastus lateralis muscle of one leg. Then the participants performed a resistance type exercise session with their other leg. Following this exercise, then we took muscle biopsies from both legs, which allowed us to assess basal muscle protein synthesis rates in both legs separately. Then half of the participants in the study ingested 30 grams of protein as sliced cheese, and half of the participants ingested 30 grams of protein as a milk protein shake. 4 hours after this protein ingestion, we then again took muscle biopsies from both legs, allowing us to assess postprandial muscle protein synthesis rates at rest and during the recovery from the resistance exercise session. And during the day, we also took blood samples at several time points to assess plasma amino acid concentrations as well as plasma trace enrichments. So in this study, we chose to match the nutritional intervention so that both groups ingested 30 grams of protein. And here you see the typical milk protein powder as we provided it. And in the protein powder, most energy comes from protein. In order to provide the participants with 30 grams of protein as cheese, we had to give it 100 grams of cheese, which provided next to energy as protein, additional energy as fat. And as such, the macronutrient composition as well as the energy content of the nutritional interventions was completely different, but we did match for 30 grams of protein. For the statistical analysis, we performed the repeated measures time, group, ANOVA for the plasma variables, which include the plasma glucose, insulin, and amino acid concentrations. And we performed the repeated measures time, leg, group, ANOVA for the muscle protein synthesis rates. And in case of significant interactions, we performed separate analyses. So in this figure, you see the plasma glucose concentrations for the cheese group in black and the milk group in white. And the vertical dotted line represents the time of protein ingestion. And you can see that following protein ingestion, there was no change in the plasma glucose concentrations in either of the groups. The plasma insulin concentration, however, did increase following the ingestion of milk protein, but did not change following the ingestion of cheese. So both these findings are in line with previous data showing a low glycemic and insulinemic response following cheese ingestion. So following milk ingestion, the plasma total amino acid concentrations did increase and then slowly returned back to baseline values within 4 hours. Following cheese ingestion, however, they did increase, but to a lower extent than when compared to the milk protein. At the end of the postprandial period, the plasma total amino acids concentrations were still elevated in the cheese group, but not in the milk group. So when we express this plasma total amino acid availability over the 4 hour period as the area under the curve, you can see that the total amino acid availability was higher in the milk group when compared to the cheese group. For the plasma essential amino acid, a similar pattern was observed, but also a higher and faster increase following milk protein ingestion, with a lower and more sustained increase following cheese ingestion. And also the plasma essential amino acid availability was higher in the milk group when compared to the cheese group. So in this figure, you show the plasma leucine concentrations, and those are important because plasma leucine is not only an amino acid that's used for protein synthesis, but it also serves as a signaling molecule for the initiation of muscle protein synthesis. And you can see in that in line with the previous figures, also there was a high and fast increase following milk protein ingestion, but a more lower and sustained increase following cheese ingestion. This shows that despite both products providing 30 grams of protein and had a similar amino acid composition, the matrix of the cheese and the milk protein did strongly affect the postprandial amino acid availability. However, in this study, we were now also interested whether this could affect the capacity to stimulate postprandial muscle protein synthesis rates. So, and the plasmalucin availability was also higher in the milk group when compared to the cheese. So in this figure, you see the muscle protein synthesis rates expressed as the mixed muscle fractional synthesis rates. And you can see that in the rested leg, there was following protein ingestion, a significant increase in muscle protein synthesis rates from basal to postprandial. And importantly, this change, this increase was not different between the cheese and the milk group. In the exercise leg, you can also see that following protein ingestion, there is a strong increase in muscle protein synthesis rates from basal to postprandial. This was again not different between the cheese and the milk group. As exercise is a strong anabolic stimulus, we did observe a higher increase in the muscle protein synthesis rates in the exercise leg when compared to the rested leg. So in conclusion, cheese ingestion is followed by an attenuated rise in plasma amino acid concentration when compared to the ingestion of milk protein concentrate. The ingestion of 30 grams of protein provided as cheese strongly increases the muscle protein synthesis rates, both at rest and during recovery from exercise. And the muscle protein synthetic response to the ingestion of 30 grams of protein provided as cheese does not differ from the response to an equivalent amount of milk protein concentrate. So altogether, this study showed that despite protein concentrates, also whole foods such as cheese can be used for muscle anabolism. I would like to finish up my presentation by thanking my colleagues from the Envery Research Group for their help with this project. I would like to thank the Dutch Dairy Association for their financial contribution to this project, and all of you present here for your time and attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you for a clear presentation. Are there any questions from my colleagues? Jatin, please.
Hi, so thank you. Yes, a very nice, clear presentation. A little unlucky because my question's kind of going to span yours and Cassie's bit before. So I presume your answer would be the same, that you put in 30 grams of protein and that's why you don't see it, you know, that's optimal or maximal, and that's why you don't see a difference in FSR. So I was just wondering why you chose such a high dose of protein if you wanted to try and dissect out the, you know, perhaps subtle differences between the food, the effect of the food matrix.
Okay, yeah, thank you for the question, Jatin. So indeed, you could consider like giving lower amounts of protein, but we specifically chose 30 grams of protein because it reflects like an amount that people would normally ingest after resistance exercise session. You could speculate that lower amounts would indeed possibly lead to smaller difference or bigger difference, and therefore show difference in muscle protein synthesis rates. But at least with the 30 grams, we do not show the differences there.
Okay, thank you.
Jose Calbert, welcome back.
Yeah, sorry, my computer crashed before. So thanks for the presentation. It was a very nice study, methodologically talking. But apart from the issue of the gain with the protein, that I agree with Jatin's comment. So there is another issue that is in regard with with the concept of slow and fast proteins. So you are manipulating a variable here that is casting empty rate. So, and also you are manipulating another variable that is solid versus fluids. Can you comment on this?
Yeah, that's indeed a good comment. So this study was not necessarily designed to capture all matrix effects and figure out everything, but we just tried to provide like a good comparison. So as you know, cheese is mainly the casein fraction of the milk protein, whereas the milk protein concentrate also still contains a 20% of whey protein that's fastly digestion. So in this, yeah, as you said, like there's different factors and different differences between the milk protein concentrate and the cheese that could have caused these differences, with the fat co-ingestion or either carbohydrates in the milk a little bit, or like the solidness that probably decreases the digestive speed a little bit. But in this study, we cannot figure out all those things. We can just say that milk protein concentrate versus cheese shows these differences. And I think the next step would indeed go in a bit more into like different comparisons and see where these differences come from and where we can manipulate those.
Thank you.
Would you expect to see any differences between your two interventions on muscle protein breakdown?
That's a good question. Of course, you know, from experience, like, it's hard to assess the muscle breakdown rates. But
you saw big differences in the insulin response.
True. So there's indeed been some discussion on, like, the effect of insulin on muscle protein synthesis rates, that there's like a small peak necessary in order to stimulate that. And I think we've reached that. But also the insulin response in the cheese group would already, I think, be sufficient also to decrease the protein breakdown rates to an amount that it's like not different between the milk and the cheese group.
Okay. Thank you. We're out of time. Thanks for a clear presentation.
Thank you.
I'm afraid we have to move on now. So the next talk is abstract 541, the ergogenicity of acute carnosine and anserine supplementation, the search for an underlying mechanism. And I think the presenter is De Jager. Hello? Sarah, are you there?
Yeah, can you hear?
Yeah, we can hear you. Over to you. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Sarah De Jager, and I am a PhD researcher at Ghent University in the team of Professor Wim de Rave. And I will present you part of my research in which I'm trying to find the mechanism underlying the ergogenic effects of acute carnosine and anserine supplementation. But first things first, what are carnosine and anserine? So both are histidine-containing dipeptides, or HDDs, as I will refer to them. And if we should ingest pure carnosine, it is known that the highly active CF1 enzyme, which is depicted here, will hydrolyze it almost immediately into its constituent components, being beta-alanine and alanistidine. This is why in our performance studies, we will add anserine to the mix. And anserine is a methylated form of carnosine, and due to the change in structure, it is less susceptible to CF1 hydrolyzation. And this will result in a higher and more prolonged peak concentration of the HCDs in plasma. And both of these molecules have various health and performance enhancing properties, such as buffering capacity, an increased calcium sensitivity, and an antioxidant function. And it's because of these specific properties that these molecules were tested as a nutritional aid to improve performance. And the idea of acute supplementation, meaning ingesting it immediately before a performance, originated in the early 50s with the Severin's phenomenon. The Russian scientist Severin measured the acute effect of dipeptides on the contractility of a neuromuscular preparation of a frog muscle. So strain is put on this muscle, and we can see that force starts to decrease rapidly until exhaustion. But then when carnosine is added, indicated by the red arrow, an immediate increase in contractile force is observed, and working capacity is prolonged beyond that of the control condition. Also, similar activity was observed when anserine was added to the solution. So carnosine and anserine appear to revive the muscle after fatigue is induced. And to date, several human performance studies were conducted with acute supplementation of carnosine and anserine. And in the following slides, I will show you some of the most important results. So a first performance study tried to replicate the Severin's phenomenon in humans, and subjects were fatigued firstly, and then they had to perform a 30-second Wingate test. And after ingesting the carnosine and anserine supplement, their power output was about 6% higher during the first 5 seconds compared to when a placebo was ingested. Similarly, in another study, peak power during 3 repeated 30-second Wingate tests in which they were not previously fatigued was 2.5% higher in the supplemented condition. Then in a third study, a dose response effect was researched, and subjects performed 5 short cycling sprints of 6 seconds, followed by 3 maximal voluntary isometric contractions. And when looking at the peak power and the peak torque, we can see that there is a stepwise effect of dose ingested, with the 30 milligram per kilogram dose giving the best results. And this is why in our following studies, we will use this dose of 30 milligrams per kilogram of both carnosine and anserine. The most well-known properties of carnosine and anserine are researched, but neither the proton buffering effect nor the antioxidant capacity were found as main mechanism of the ergogenic effects. So these results, along with the fact that improvement was found on the peak power and force, suggest that there is a different mechanism at play. So therefore, during my PhD, I'm trying to unravel this underlying mechanism. And we've seen that there are, in fact, performance improvements found with the supplements. However, we do not know yet what the responsible mechanism for these effects are. So we performed two studies to look into two separate mechanisms. In study A, we looked into the effect of carnosine and anserine on the neuromuscular function, the hypothesis of an effect at the neuromuscular level derived from the Severin's phenomenon that I mentioned earlier. And then in study B, we researched the effect on muscle blood flow. So first, in study A, our subjects, 15 men, came to the lab on two occasions, and once they received the supplement of carnosine and anserine, and on the other time, they received the placebo. Before and after the supplement, a blood sample was withdrawn, which was used to determine the increase in plasma concentration of the HCDs. Then the subjects performed 3 maximal voluntary isometric contractions with electrical stimulation of the femoral nerve, and EMG and Biodex data were used to determine whether there was indeed an effect on neuromuscular function. And then lastly, they performed 5 cycling sprints of 6 seconds, which was similar as in the previous dose response study. We compared the voluntary activation level, or the VOL, between both conditions, and the VOL is the percentage of the full potential of the muscle that we can voluntarily activate. And we expected the VOL to increase after ingesting carnosine and anserine, but this, however, was not the case. Unfortunately, also during the study, no performance improvement was found. So not for peak power during the sprints, nor for the peak torque during the maximal voluntary contractions. And this was in contrast with the studies that I discussed earlier. So for example, the dose response study. So to conclude, although no performance improvement was observed during the study, we can exclude an effect on neuromuscular function as potential mechanism, since the increase in plasma concentration of carnosine and anserine was very high, and this did not result in any improvement, not on the VOL nor on any other EMG parameter. And therefore, we were forced to look at an alternative mechanism and performed study B, in which we wanted to see whether carnosine and anserine could increase muscle blood flow after performance. This hypothesis is based on the idea of a carnosine-histidine-histamine pathway. And important to mention is that the existence of this pathway to date has not been confirmed yet. There are, however, studies in rats that have shown a significant increase in blood flow after applying carnosine. And the idea is that carnosine is hydrolyzed into histidine by the highly active CN1 enzyme, from which histamine is formed by the histidine decarboxylase enzyme. And we know that histamine is a vasodilator, meaning that it can increase blood flow to certain areas of the body. And increased muscle perfusion could help speed up recovery from a previous performance by a faster elimination of metabolic byproducts, for example. So we wanted to measure whether the supplement indeed increases muscle blood flow by using an echo Doppler technique. And 8 men were randomly subjected to 3 conditions. Once they took a placebo, another time they took our supplement of carnosine and anserine, and once they ingested antihistamines. And these antihistamines are shown to have a blood flow reducing effect after performance. Our subjects performed a high intensity interval training consisting of 4 intensive bouts of 4 minutes. And then 30 minutes before and 2 hours after the exercise, blood flow in the femoral artery was measured using an echo Doppler technique to measure baseline and recovery values. This figure shows the change in blood flow after the intensive training compared to the baseline flow. And as you can see from the graph, muscle perfusion is increased compared to baseline up to 30 minutes, but no real differences were found between the 3 conditions. A better way to see whether there are differences in blood flow is by calculating the incremental area under the curve, or the EIC. And this is the total volume that was increased above baseline during those 2 hours of recovery. And here we can see that the antihistamines condition was in fact a good negative control, as it was able to reduce muscle blood flow by 27%. Remember that I said earlier, histamine increases blood flow through vasodilation, and the antihistamines block this vasodilation, resulting in a lower EIC. For the carnosine and aspirin condition, we were expecting the reverse to happen. So due to the carnosine breakdown, we expected to attain an increase in histamine and a more pronounced vasodilation. But unfortunately, no increase in incremental area under the curve was found after taking the supplement. So to conclude, we looked into the effects of our supplement on neuromuscular function, which was excluded as responsible mechanism. Then we looked at the effect on post-exercise muscle perfusion, but again, our hypothesis could not be confirmed. So in the future, we will have to look further for a responsible mechanism before we can make prescriptions on which type of exercise will be benefited by using this new ergogenic aid. A possibility also is that there is not only one responsible mechanism, but that carnosine and aspirin, due to their variety of functions, can influence performance on different levels through multiple mechanisms working together. So this was my presentation. Thank you for listening, and I hope everything was clear.
Thank you, Sarah. Yes, very clear. Could I open the floor to questions, please? Jatin, thank you.
Hi, good morning. Thank you very much for your presentation. I was just wondering, so I know you're looking for different mechanisms, but did you specifically investigate some of the sort of traditional mechanisms, sort of blood pH and glutathione redox state and things like that?
Those mechanisms were actually already researched by some of my colleagues. So in the previous studies that I showed, we investigated the effect on pH buffering, so we measured the lactate and the bicarbonate status, and we also measured the effect on the glutathione status, and we found no differences whatsoever. So that's why we excluded that mechanism.
And in your presentation, you seem to discount study A quite quickly. I was just wondering if you can tell me more about, you know, how confident you are in perhaps, you know, your familiarization of your subjects, control, etc. Why you're confident, you know, because you didn't see a change in performance. So perhaps that's not a good place to discount that there's no mechanism there.
Yeah, it's true. It's a difficulty, the fact that we can't find a performance improvement. However, we used LCMS to measure plasma values of carnosine and aspirin, and we found very high concentrations. And then we compared this with the concentrations that were used in another study on rats, however, and they found at very low concentrations actually an increase in nerve activity. So that's why, because of these high concentrations that we expected to, if something would happen on the nerve level, that we would see it, regardless of the fact that there were no effects on performance.
Okay.
I have a question, if I may. So carnosine, in my understanding, is pretty much restricted to the muscle pool. So the body store of carnosine is almost all in skeletal muscle, is what I'm saying. So why would you expect an effect of ingesting carnosine to affect the nervous system or vasodilatation?
That's a good question. Well, we started by giving carnosine, and then we saw that by the CN1 enzyme, it is hydrolyzed almost immediately, and that's why we added aspirin to keep up its stability. And we expect maybe to, like I said, for the effect on the vasodilation, it's possible that the degradation of carnosine into histidine and then a further.
So did you measure? Did you measure the half-life of plasma carnitine, in your studies?
During previous studies, we measured the half-life and the breakdown of carnitine. Yes.
And how quick was it?
It was quick, about 1.5 minutes, maybe, after in an in vitro study. So after adding it to a vial of heparin plasma.
No, I mean it in your volunteer studies. Did you measure plasma carnosine?
Yes. If you give carnosine solely carnosine without anserine or another components, it breaks. It's not measurable, so it breaks down almost immediately.
Yeah.
So that's why we added anserine to the mix, because yes, we can measure carnosine and anserine together.
So under those conditions, sorry, I'm not making myself clear. Under those conditions, what was the difference in the half-life of carnosine with anserine present?
With anserine present, I don't really know the exact time, but we could see a measurable peak of both carnosine and anserine, which was absent when carnosine alone was given.
Okay.
After the peak of after 60 minutes after ingestion.
All right. Thank you, Sarah. I'm afraid we're out of time. And we now need to move to the final presentation, which is carbohydrate requirements for strength training performance, a systematic review. And this is abstract ID 739. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. Let me see here. Okay, can you see my screen?
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. I'm Frederick from University of Agder in Norway. And my topic is carbohydrate requirements for strength training performance, a systematic review. Carbohydrates and glycogen are known to be the preferred energy substrate in aerobic sports at moderate to high intensities. A high intake is therefore recommended for optimal performance. And carbohydrates can be stored as glycogen, 100 grams in the liver and 350 to 700 grams in the muscles. But when you go to resistance training, that relies primarily on the phosphagen and anaerobic glycolysis pathways. And at ATP production from one set of biceps curls at 80% of 1RM to failure has been observed to be provided through a few percent from ATP stores, a little bit more from creatine, 16%, and above 80% from glycolysis. Then how much does resistance training deplete glycogen stores? This is not a full overview, but a representative one. And you can see here that if you do 3 sets of 50 repetitions with isokinetic work, glycogen is depleted by 10%. And if you do 6 sets of high load, it goes up to almost 40%. And if you increase it further to 8, 9, 16, or 20 sets, it seems to be around 30 to 40%. So I've not found a study that has depleted whole muscle glycogen more than 40% after resistance training. However, a substantial number of fibers can still be near depleted, even when the whole muscle level remains only partially depleted. In a study that did 16 sets of lower body resistance exercise with high load, and they observed that whole muscle glycogen was decreased by 38%, and subcellular compartments in type 2 fibers by 50%, but almost half of the type 2 fibers demonstrated near full depletion. and low glycogen levels have been observed to contribute to muscle fatigue, where the mechanisms is believed to be an alter in the muscle contraction via lowered muscle excitability and calcium release. So what is the current recommendations for strength performance? Previous reviews has recommended daily carbohydrate intakes of 8 to 10 grams per kilo body weight during heavy anaerobic exercise, or 4 to 7 grams per kilo body weight for strength athletes. But is a high carbohydrate intake needed for strength performance? Research on carbohydrates and strength performance. The first paper we found was from 1991, which showed a tendency for a performance benefit after carbohydrate intake. Then a few years later, two abstracts were published, which showed no effect of carbohydrates on performance. Then in 1999, another study was tested strength performance after glycogen depletion and high carbohydrates, and they saw an increase in performance. And in 2000, there was a study that showed no effect. And after 2000, there has been several more papers. So research on the topic is so far not clear. So our aim was to systematically analyze the research on carbohydrate intake for strength performance. We did a systematic search in 3 databases, Medline, SportDiscuss, and Scalo in the end of January. And we also screened the references of the included studies and related reviews. Our inclusion criteria were in healthy participants under 60 years of age. And we included trials where carbohydrate intake was manipulated between conditions and tested dynamic strength and power test, either acutely or after a period of strength training. And they tested at least one of the primary outcome, maximal strength, power, repetitions to failure, or isokinetic performance. And in addition, if they had at least one primary outcome, we also included secondary outcomes as isometric strength, sprint, jump, agility, throws, and Wingate performance. And we included studies were divided into categories, which is a bit updated since we submitted the abstract. The categories are divided into acute strength tests after category 1, acute carbohydrate supplementation, 2, exercise-induced glycogen depletion prior to carbohydrate manipulation, and 3, short-term carbohydrate manipulation above 1 day to 7 days. And lastly, changes in strength after longer term period of diet manipulation and resistance training. Results. Search identified 576 papers. And we ended up including 44 papers, 19 acute, 4 glycogen depletion studies, 7 short-term, and 14 long-term studies. And the sample consisted of young participants, mostly men, but a few papers was in females. They were 25 years old, and 29 of the 44 studies were in resistance-trained participants, and 5 were in athletes. The last 10 were in untrained or active participants. So results for the acute supplementation studies, 19 studies, 16 crossover trials, and 3 randomized controlled trials. They had an average of 11 participants in each study, and the dosage of carbohydrate supplement ranged from 0.2 to 2 grams per kilo body weight, but the most used was 1 gram per kilo body weight with maltodextrin. And it was usually ingested 15 to 60 minutes before exercise and or within the test session. And it was compared to a non-caloric or lower energy content placebo supplement. And in 10 of the 19 studies, the supplements were ingested in a previous fasted state in the morning. And a typical session was 1 to 2 exercises times 3 to 5 sets to failure. Yeah, and performance measurements here were total training volume, maximal strength, or isokinetic work. 6 of the 19 studies found carbohydrate to increase performance, namely increased training volume and isokinetic work. Here, 5 of them, the placebo condition, were in a fasted state. And the last one was fed, but the resistance training was a very high volume, 16 sets. And 2 studies found a negative performance effect of carbohydrates, but 1 was in comparison to a high protein supplement. Interestingly, 1 study found that the performance enhancement effect after a placebo breakfast was similar to a carbohydrate breakfast. And there was 1 study that looked at the dose response effect, but there was no consistent dose response effect after 15, 30, or 60 grams of carbohydrates. Over to the exercise-induced glycogen depletion studies, there were 4 studies, average 10 male participants in each. And the depletion workouts were designed to deplete glycogen stores, but was not directly measured. And strength performance was measured as training volume or power. Here, high carbohydrate intake enhanced performance in 3 out of 4 studies compared to lower carbohydrate conditions in both of the outcomes. However, the low conditions were either non-caloric or low in total daily caloric intake. In the study, when calories were matched, no between group differences were observed. Short term, from 2 days to 7 days, there was 7 studies. Daily carbohydrate intakes ranged between 30 to 350 grams, average 145 grams in the lower carbohydrate diets, and 165 to above 600 grams, average 333 in the higher carbohydrate conditions. And here, performance was measured as changes in maximal strength, isokinetic work, power, and training volume. And here, there was no between group differences in 6 studies and 1 in favor of the lower carbohydrate condition in squat strength, hand grip, and vertical jump height. Longer term carbohydrate manipulation. 14 studies that lasted for 3 weeks to 3 months, average was 8 weeks. Here, daily carbohydrate intakes ranged between 15 to 250 grams in the lower carbohydrate groups and 170 to 758 grams in the higher carbohydrate groups. 5 of them were isocaloric and protein matched, and they saw no group differences in strength performance in either of them. 3 studies were isocaloric but not protein matched. Here, 1 ketogenic diet group increases Wingate performance compared to the non-ketogenic diet group. And 6 studies were not calorie matched or protein matched. Here, 1 high carbohydrate group increases 1 RM more than the ketogenic diet group. Summary of the results. 10 out of 44 studies observed a performance benefit of higher carbohydrate intakes. But a higher carbohydrate intake did not increase performance in the short or longer term studies. Some considerations. None of the studies measured actual muscle glycogen before or after exercise. And most of the acute studies was compared to a non-caloric placebo. And half of them were also in a pre-fasted state before supplementation. And we can ask if strength performance can be lower at a certain glycogen threshold. When muscle glycogen is severely lowered at the whole muscle level, and some individual fibers or compartments become depleted. In conclusion, the available evidence does not indicate any strength performance enhancing effect of higher dietary carbohydrate intakes in most circumstances. However, the degree of glycogen depletion, in addition to the localized glycogen depletion and the impact on strength performance, needs more research. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The floor is now open for questions, please. Jatin, thank you. Then Maria.
Morning. Thank you very much for your presentation. I'm just curious to know why you haven't performed any sort of meta-analysis on the data that you've extracted.
Yeah, it's because it's so quite different in the study designs. Dosages and timing of the supplement, and also the training volume and performance measurements. So, yeah.
So, doesn't that mean that your question was probably too broad?
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah.
Yeah. And I just wondered, in your analysis, so you begin by saying how important number of reps and fiber type are. So, were you able to integrate any of that data into your findings? So, how many of those studies reported fiber type?
Of our studies in the included, or those that measured muscle glycogen?
Any of the ones that you included in your review?
They don't measure. They didn't do biopsies.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much.
Maria, please.
Yes. Thank you. I agree that probably the research question was a bit too broad. My question reflects a bit if any study looked at the hormonal response to exercise with and without carbohydrate.
Not that I can think of, no.
Well, my second question would also relate it. So let's say that the purpose of your review was mainly to look at the effects of carbohydrate on performance, not on recovery eventually, yeah. Because it might be more interesting for athletes who combine resistance training and maybe then have an extra session of their main sport. So this is not something you have been looking into at all.
No.
Any further questions? Okay, thank you, Frederick. So we will end the session there, but if I could ask my colleagues to remain online so we can discuss the presentations.